Well, I guess Rui already gave you a number of standard disclaimers for such a lecture series. In particular, what I'm going to speak about, in principle, as you perhaps saw in some rudimentary lecture notes that I wrote up, it's set at a rather elementary level, and I see many experts in the field, in the room, so for those who are experts, it's going to be either boring, or on the other hand, when I make mistakes, you want to correct me, right? So I have one more disclaimer in addition, especially for today's lecture. Some part of it, including some examples, will be identical to those in the lecture of Rui. But I hope it's okay, so we want to view it from a somewhat different angle. For the exercise sessions, that's Alejandro and Roy who are going to help you. Could you? Yeah, so then I don't quite know how it's going to be organized, because that's the same session for two lecture series. But keep in mind that some of the exercises and some of the material is identical. Perhaps it's not so contradictory in the end. Right, so I want to start perhaps with a very brief intro, just to say why we are speaking about the modular spaces of flat connections in this Poisson school. So moduli of flat connections. Well, and it's going to be moduli of flat connections on two-dimensional surfaces. Right. Why is it an important topic? First of all, this topic is mathematically important. Well, here probably one can give many reasons, and let me give at least two. So one thing is that it's related to moduli of holomorphic bundles, and this is by the Narasimhan-Seshadri theorem. Perhaps I don't write it explicitly. So that's probably one of the big motivations, and here we go in the field of algebraic geometry, and then, well, there are various higher sciences which come in, like the whatever Langlands duality or things, well, that I don't know much about. But this is one of the avenues which make modular flat connections important in mathematics. And the other connection, which is also very beautiful and very important, it's a relation to the so-called Shem-Simons theorem in quantum field theory, which is intimately related to 3D topology. So here we'll see, maybe I'll try to manufacture an exercise about this relation. So this actually one can perhaps even spell it now. So the moduli space of flat connections comes up as the so-called reduced phase space for this infinite, a priori infinite dimensional system. But then the reduced phase space turns out to be finite dimensional, and this is the moduli space of flat connections. So I would say these are two big reasons why this is a very important space. Now, maybe a little bit closer to what we're going to be doing. It is related to the theory of moment maps and reduction. So these are the words already mentioned today in the first class by Rui. And then also, well, this is saying more or less the same, but with different words. Moduli spaces of flat connections are non-trivial examples of Poisson and symplectic spaces. So actually, well, these two big reasons, they will be more like theoretical for us in this course, and these are the two things that we wanted to explore in more detail. But this is just to have in mind that in principle, this moduli space of or moduli spaces of flat connections, this is one of the central objects in a bigger field. Well, may I actually erase the information about food? Okay. Now, well, some more words about the plan for the course. Well, in fact, today I don't plan to speak about the moduli of flat connections, and instead I will be recalling some standard facts about the moment maps and reduction. So that's why it goes a little bit parallel to what Rui did today. So then, tomorrow we'll start working with the moduli. And well, there are two approaches or two pictures that we're going to explore. One is the infinite dimensional picture, where actually we're going to do reduction, we're going to use moment maps in the infinite dimensional setting, even though here we're going to discuss them just in the finite dimensional setting. And then we'll try to think of a finite dimensional description. In fact, that's perhaps what one should say it already here. So the moduli space of flat connections is a reduced space, but the easiest way to obtain this reduced space is from the infinite dimensional picture. You start with something which is a kind of infinite dimensional symplectic manifold in some sense, and then you do reduction. You obtain the moduli space. However, there are some inconveniences in this approach. So it would be preferable to have some finite dimensional picture, finite dimensional description. And over the years, several descriptions or several methods to work with it finite dimensionally, they were worked out. So I'll show you in some way two of them. One of them goes under the name of the Goldman bracket, and the other one, which perhaps I put here as a separate topic, the so-called group family moment maps. So you see, basically, one has to change, if one wants to work finite dimensionally, one has to pay a price and work with analogs of moment maps and reduction, but in a somewhat different setting. So one goes a little bit outside of symplectic and Poisson geometry. And then, towards the end, you'll probably arrive at the beautiful Witten's volume formula for the symplectic volumes of the moduli space. The original plan was also to show you a little bit of the Verlinde formula, but I'm not sure this would work out this timing. If time permits, I was thinking to finish with some brief intro to some of the conference talks. So I checked on the on the conference program. It looks like there are several talks in the program next week, which deal with various aspects of moduli or flat connections. And well, if by Thursday I understand enough of what they plan to do, I'll try to give you some hints and try to link it up with more elementary material that we want to look at in the lecture series. So that's more or less my introduction. I don't know whether you have some questions at this moment. If not, let's just start with the introduction into moment maps introduction. Well, so I would like to start with a definition of Hamiltonian G-spaces. Let me fix some notation. Let's say M will be smooth manifold, and G, in many cases, but not always, compact, connected Lie group, and small g will be the Lie algebra of G. So then we say that the following triple: the manifold, the two form on M, and a map from M to the dual of the Lie algebra is a G Hamiltonian space if the following conditions are satisfied. So one thing, we want G to act on M. And here perhaps it's good to introduce some notation. So if G acts on M, then there is a map from the Lie algebra into the vector field on M. So these are vector fields. And traditionally, we denote it like the element of G x is mapped to the fundamental fundamental vector field X M. So these are fundamental vector fields. Okay. Well, so second, M omega is symplectic. So you already saw the formal definition in the Lewis course. So G omega, so omega is a closed two form, and the pairing induced by omega on the tangent space at each point is non-determinant. Right. So the next condition is the moment map condition. So if we contract omega is the fundamental vector field. Here I'm not completely sure, right? There are different notations. So this is omega computed where I substitute xm instead of the first vector field in omega. So this is the differential of the pairing of mu and x. Perhaps one small remark here. Once we have this moment map condition, we know that omega is a g-invariant 2-form. Why is that? That's because if we compute the lead derivative of omega with respect to the fundamental vector field and use the Cortin's magic formula, so we rewrite the lead derivative as the anti-commutator of the Dirac differential and the contraction xm, then what's going to happen? On the one hand, we have d omega equal to zero by the fact that omega is symplectic. And on the other hand, the second term, is it a sound? Sounds more natural. So now this and in this term, that's because we have this equation, we're getting d squared mu x. And this is zero because
which is another microphone.
Yeah, let's see how it goes. Okay, so you see the lead derivatives of omega vanish, and I assume that my group is connected. So this actually implies that omega is g invariant. Right. Now, one more condition that I would like to add by the way, about the use of the blackboards, I got an impression that actually if you use two of them here, then we don't see much because of the desk. Is it correct? So I was thinking just to use one of them. Okay. So the fourth condition is as follows. Now we have this map mu to G star, the dual of the Lie algebra, and we want to require it to be equivariant for the quadjoint action point. So this definition has many parts in it, but it turns out to be a very successful definition. I'm not going to explore all the consequences of it in the talk or in this lecture series, but from time to time I will mention some theorems which derive from this definition. So this definition is a very, very successful, very nice definition. And we'll try to take it as a model, both for our finite dimensional and infinite dimensional dealings with the moduli space. Perhaps it's good to give some examples here. And so some of those examples are obtained in the following way. So I said that we're using the quadjoint action on G star. So one basic example in this context are quadjoint orbits. So let's say we take a point in G star, and actually in the meantime, after having written the notes, I decided to change notation. We'll see how it goes. So then the orbit which passes through psi, so this will be points of the form the joint G minus 1. So in the lower set, you have the joint G star of time, where G runs through all the elements of G. Of course, for, as a set, it doesn't matter what it is. You can replace G by G minus 1.
And you mean by star, you mean the transpose?
Yeah, right. By star, I mean the transpose in the following sense. So let's say we have the adjoint action, which are operators on the Lie algebra. And this is the action which integrates the adjoint representation, right? Adjoint x, which sends y to the bracket of x and y. So now, on the dual space, we have, as you want, a transpose or the dual representation. So this adjoint star in the dual representation. I guess this still sounds a little bit abstract. In a second, we'll give a more concrete example. But perhaps here, it's a good time to cite the following theorem. So, like in terms of Hamiltonian G-spaces, now I just gave you a space, and it is rather obvious that the group acts on this space just by the co-adjoint action. Now, what about making it into a Hamiltonian G-space? So the claim is that there is a unique two-form on Polk psi, such that psi, together with this co-adjoint action, these two form, well, let me call it the magic sign. And the moment map, which now will be just the identity map, which sends Polk psi into G star. Hamiltonian in fact there is a complete formula so this form is unique but there is a concrete and rather beautiful formula, in fact even several beautiful formulas for this simplex form. Now let me give you one of them, and to make a connection to the other one is the first exercise on the first problem set. So this form omega psi is the name of the Kirill of two form, and Kirill was not, as far as I understand, he was not that much interested in Poisson symplectic geometry. He was interested in representation theory. And that's where this two form came up naturally. So assume that we have a point eta of this orbit sitting inside J star. And assume that we're looking at two elements, x and y, in G. And now what we can do, we can evaluate, in fact, maybe what I've done was not so good notation-wise. May erase this sign. Let me just call it omega. You'll see why. So that was not a good move. So it was bad in the notes. So that's because I now want to evaluate the magnitude point eta. And if I already have psi, then there would be 2 points that I would have to indicate. So let me evaluate the matter at the point eta on two fundamental vector fields, xO and yO. So then the famous Kirillov's formula is that this is the pairing between eta and the Lie bracket of x and y. So that's the great formula for these two forms. In fact, well, this is a very concrete formula, but frankly, I don't find it so concrete or so useful. So that's why in the exercise one, I'm suggesting to you to give a different formula for the same two forms. In fact, how do I want to go about it? The idea is as follows. Well, now, do you think there is a point somewhere? Anyone sees any? So you see, in this description of the quadrant orbits, in some way the quadrant orbit comes together as a map from the group G, right? So we have a map. Let's call it X I. Well, I don't know. Perhaps I would have to erase X I again, but let me take a risk. So it comes together as a map from G to O psi. And this map, it simply maps G to the adjoint star G minus 1 O psi. Right? Of course, here we have chosen one base point, and we get this map. Now, I claim that one can write a beautiful formula for the pullback of the two form to a group. And, well, what is beautiful, what is nice about this pullback? So the two form on O, in most cases, it's not at all exact. It's a closed form, but usually, or on many occasions, it represents a non-trivial cohomology class. And this is one of the interesting questions about the Kirillov form. What is its cohomology class? But this guy is always exact. So it's G of something. In order to write down this something, I'll need to introduce a little bit of notation related to differential forms on groups. In fact, that's something that I want to discuss with you anyways very early in the course. I'm going to use some very bad notations. And I highly recommend these notations to you. So that's just one part of this destructive element in my teaching. So I try to convince you to use this very bad notation. So, so we have a Lie group, and we have to deal these differential forms on Lie groups, on many topics of Lie groups, and so on. In particular, very important objects are so-called left and right invariant Marvel-Platon forms. So these are one forms on the group. These values in the Lie algebra. And you can characterize them by the following properties. So the group acts on itself on the left. and on the right. And the left invariant and right invariant Marfer transforms, you can think of them in the following way. So you evaluate the left invariant Marfer transform on the left invariant fundamental vector field, and you get back the element x from which you started. Or the same goes for the right invariant Marfer transform. However, what I want to suggest is to pretend that our groups are matrix groups. Pretend G is a matrix group. Well, if G were a matrix group, then there are much nicer, well, there are simple expressions for theta left and theta right. So theta left is a left invariant Marfer transform, and you can write it as g minus 1 to g in terms of group elements. Of course, if you have an absolute group, this doesn't make much sense. But if it's a matrix group, that's a very good expression. You multiply matrices. So the same applies to the right invariant Marfer transform. You can actually see why this left invariant or right invariant? Why those expressions here left invariant and here right invariant? Just try to multiply g on subset on the left, and you will see that g and g minus 1 will cancel out. And here you can also multiply it on the right, and you will see that those things will say if I have here like replaced by gh and here gh minus 1, if h is a constant element, it will cancel out. Right? So that's the notation that I want to suggest to you. In fact, the simple exercise is as follows. Use this very bad notation and prove the Marfer term structure equations. So which say that g theta left is 1 half minus 1 half. Leave bracket theta left is theta left. And g theta right is 1 half of the leave bracket of theta right is theta right. Just a hint, here the minus sign comes from differentiation g minus 1. Here there should be also a minus sign coming from this derivative, but then there is another minus sign when you commute g and the 1 form dg. So that's how you see already what are the correct signs. Now if you get back here, so the expression that I want to suggest for the proof, let me see. Now I changed notation several times, and as a consequence, I don't quite know what is right and what is wrong. Okay, apparently at the moment, the following expression is correct. It is believed to be correct. So it is repairing between psi and theta right. Or you can say z and here psi. Dg minus 1. I would actually prefer this writing. So in fact, one lesson that we can draw from this calculation is as follows. So we're gonna need to describe symplectic forms on complicated spaces. Like the module space is sometimes a relatively complicated object. Now there will be a canonical symplectic form on it, and it's usually easier to describe the symplectic form of some complicated object if you pull back to a sufficiently big space. So now that's what we've done. So if quadrant orbits, well, that's for discussion. They're complicated spaces or they're easy spaces, but for sure the group is an easier space. So you pull back and you get differential form to the group. And on the one hand, you get some really easy primitive for you, so it becomes exact, and you get an easy primitive. In principle, that will be our strategy also to deal with the description of the moduli spaces. Now perhaps one more remark, and it also links with what Rui was explaining in his lecture, and perhaps that's an occasion for me to mention the word Poisson for the first time. So Rui has explained that the dual of a Lie algebra is a Poisson space, and actually, perhaps what I want to say is the following. Let me give you the Poisson bracket of a linear function. Suppose that I choose two elements of my Lie algebra G, and I'm looking at two. Well, eta was the name of the variable in G star. So I take two linear functions, right? So these are. Linear functions on G star. In a finite dimensional situation, so this means that G star is just isomorphic to G, and that's what I'm using here, right? So these are linear functions of eta. Now, this canonical Poisson structure of G star is characterized. So this Poisson structure goes under the name of Kirillov-Poisson Sturio, or famously KKS. Well, notice that the right hand side of this equation is exactly the same as the right-hand side of this equation. Right? So in fact, there are not that many combinations that I can sensibly build from an element of the dual space and two elements of the Lie algebra. Right? In fact, there is only one. And that's this one that shows up on the right-hand side. But wait a second. One of them tells you what is the symplectic form. And the other one is telling you what is the Poisson bracket. The answer is still the same. It's a little bit confusing. I invite you to just think a little bit about it. How it is possible. Rui is teaching us that the Poisson bracket and the symplectic form, they are inverse to each other. Yet the answer is still the same, right? It doesn't change. So think about it. How it is possible at all? In fact, this second exercise on the problem set, I'm not going to describe in detail, but the exercise about the cotangent bundle, which also coincides by chance this one of the Rui's exercises. So this exercise is explaining how it's actually possible. But think about it. So that's the same answer. Two matrices or two objects which are supposed to be inverse of each other. Perhaps one more concrete example and one more construction about moduli maps. In fact, my goal today is to build some kind of baby versions of the moduli spaces. So
So one-way tunnel.
Let's really go down to simple examples. Let's say G is the group SU2. So then the U space of the corresponding Lie algebra, well, it's three-dimensional, so it's just isomorphic to the space R3. Now, what is this quadrant action? We know that there is a canonical map from SU2 to SO3, and the quadrant action is just the action of SO3 on R3 by rotation. Now, quadrant orbits. Well, that's the point at the origin. Plus the family of two spheres. Now, perhaps it makes sense to write down the curl of two form on those two spheres, just to give you a concrete example. It is convenient to use, let's say I look at a sphere of radius r, and it is convenient to use the following funny coordinates. I choose an axis which will be my vertical axis, let's say z, and I will characterize the positions of the points by the value of z, and by the value of some polar angle for rotations around this vertical axis. So then it turns out that the curl of form will be exactly this theta fetch dz. I must say that the signs, right? So the sign conventions here, I don't quite know. Who knows? Maybe it is dz fetch dz theta. In any event, I leave you to figure out at the exercise sessions. Perhaps just to illustrate how it works, this moment map equation, right? So a concrete example. D over d theta is one of the fundamental vector fields which correspond to rotations. This is the rotation around the z-axis. Now, what the moment map equation would tell us, so we take d over d theta, d theta vs dz, and we get dz. So z is a moment map for those rotations around the vertical axis. Perhaps one more observation. I said that in the end we hope to come up with some volume formulas for symplectic volumes. Of course, moduli spaces of flat connections are more complicated spaces, but usually when you try to study them first, as a first example, you look at quadrant orbits. Whatever you want to do with moduli spaces later on, you first have to do this quadrant orbits. So what is the volume of this two-sphere of radius r with respect to our two-form? Well, that's just this integral. And this integral, 0 to pi, is theta times the integral from minus r to r dz. And this gives us 4 pi times r. Notice that this symplectic area is somewhat different from the Riemannian area that we are used to in our elementary calculus classes. But, well, that's not a very important observation. Now, one construction that I want to show you, or want to remind you, so once you have two G Hamiltonian spaces, you can build the third one. So assuming you have I, omega I, mu I, mi, Keep going in. So I equal to 1 and 2. So we can build a new one simply by taking the product of the two spaces. Now, well, from here there are two natural projections from the product with M1 and M2. Let's say Y1 and 2. Well, we simply add two forms. Well, I don't write the G action as part of the data, but we want to use the diagonal G action, which sends a pair of points to the points moved by the element G. And finally, the new moment map is just the sum of two moment maps in question. Well, it's going to be an important observation for us. It's going to be an important example. But let me illustrate it by using this example of two spheres. So let me choose R1, R2, RK. Some K positive, a couple of positive reals. So then, well, what I can do now, I can repeat this product procedure for those spheres together with this SO3, or if you want S4, SU2 action. So I just take the product of those two spheres. So that's going to be an SU2 Hamiltonian space. And there will be a moment map, this value in R3. And let's just imagine how this moment map looks like. So let's picture this moment map. Well, you see, we have to add the moment maps for each component. What is the moment map for the first one? This will be a three-dimensional vector with length equal to R1. And then, well, to this vector, you want to add the next one, U2, and so on. And in the end, the root of this vector UK. Is the norm equal to RK. So that's how it's going to look like. So those piecewise linear maps, this given length of each piece. So that gives you the proper moment map. Now today we're going to end up with the notion of reduction and with one example of reduction. So reduction is one of the, so as I said, that's a big definition. It has many consequences. Reduction, mentioned also in the Rudy's talk, is one of the consequences of the definition. One, I would say, of four major applications. So,
so we assume that we have a data of a human thought in G space, M omega and mu. And we choose a point psi inside G space. Now, let's introduce a stabilizer of this point in the quadrant action. So these are elements of G. Which don't hold it for the point sign. Now, it turns out, well, it's easy to see that G psi acts on the fiber of the moment map. This is essentially because the moment map is equilibrium. So this means if we move the points here, then the point in the image is moved by this action, but this action is trivial. So, this line acts on the fiber. And so, that this action is free. In fact, that's a whole big industry on how to relax this condition, or how one can replace this condition by something more subtle. So this is highly negotiable. But for a moment, let's say it is free. In many cases, for moduli spaces, this freeness condition or the analog of this freeness condition is not satisfied. Well, so then we define M psi. Quotient space of the fiber by the action of psi, and this space is simplex. So let me just recall the standard construction. Louis already gave you the construction for the Poisson side. Let me just write the formulas on the beautiful formulas on the symplectic side. So we have the fiber of the moment map, which is embedded in the manifold, and we have a projection to M psi. So let me denote those maps alpha and beta. And then, well, there is a unique two-form omega psi on M psi, such that alpha star omega psi is equal to beta star omega. Well, my apologies for bringing up such standard facts or such trivialities, but just for completeness of the picture. Perhaps one more remark, which is actually the same remark as Rui already gave to you. So this is a relatively tricky construction which produces new symplectic spaces. But it's easy to produce a new Poisson space starting from a Hamiltonian G space. One should just consider M on G. Of course, this space well, this is usually not a manifold, so this space might have some difficulties. If here we can still reasonably hope that something like free or maybe some kind of mild generalizations of free or freeness condition can still hold, here this would be very, very restrictive to just think that the action is free on all the space. So here we're going to get some serious singularities to do this in general. Nevertheless, on some occasions, we want to do it for the model. Now, the very last remark, or the very last example. So we have now this construction, and we have this example of the products of spheres acted by... Right? So we have this example of spheres acted by the group SU2, or SO3. So let's consider the reduced space which corresponds to the value of psi equal to 0. Example, m is equal to this product. Two spheres, and we choose psi equal to 0. Now, what is this m0? Well, let me draw it. You see now, we have this drawing, right? This moment map is given by this piecewise linear map. But now, what does it mean that psi is equal to 0? What does it mean that we look at this fiber of 0? This means that it has to come back. It has to return. So we have something called this source. And then, in the end, it comes back, right? So mu1 plus mu2 plus so on plus muk is now equal to 0. So that's why it goes under the name of polygon spaces. So these are three-dimensional, the polygons in the in the space are three, but then they're not planar. They kind of allow it to go in all possible directions. And then we divided by the action of SO3. So then we allow it to rotate. So the claim is, given those radii, R1, R1 to RK, there is a natural symplectic structure on this space. In fact, well, one problem that I'm giving you in the first problem set is to discover an interesting integrable system on this space. So, an exercise. Discover an integrable system. And this integrable system, the functions, the Hamiltonians of this integrable system, they're just norms. Let me see what was the right count. I think TOI plus 1, right? So I was thinking we'll be able to do it here, but I think it goes very well also for an exercise. For a generic choice of those R's, assuming that the space is non-empty, right? Let's make a generic choice such that this space is non-empty, because it's easy to make it empty. Like, just make one of those R's huge and all the others of reasonable size, right? Then the sum of even k minus 1 vectors of reasonable size, it will never be equal to the one which is huge. So it's easy to make it empty. But assume it's not empty. What's the generic dimension? Or what's the maximal generic dimension? Then, of course, Once you know the generic dimension, and once you see that there is an integrable system, you will be you'll be able to see whether it's a completely integrable system, whether there is enough variables to make it completely integrable in the sense of Lewis criteria of the mass.
You're not claiming this is
true, are you? Oh, it is like, okay, that's also, that's you mean the functions of the space? Oh, the space, this depends on the choice of parameters. In many cases, it is smooth. Like it depends on, so here perhaps I can say what's the criteria. Sometimes it's not smooth. To be not smooth, you need different stabilizers at different points. When do you have a smaller a bigger stabilizer? That's when you have a number of, that's when you can compose something like this. When some of the R's add up to the sum of the other subset of R's. That's in fact exactly when you can split those KR's into subsets, sum of the one is equal to sum of the other. So in this case, you do get these non-smooth points. Otherwise, it is smooth. Right, so generically, it is smooth. Generically, it's a nice symplectic manifold, and so I invite you to compute the dimension of this manifold and discover a completely integrable system. So the last word. So in fact, this is one of the examples of the moduli spaces. So the moduli spaces are these and many more complicated spaces. We'll see it in the next lecture.